is currently exploring the disruptive fields of innovation such as change to sustainable energy in Germany, the future of work and the effects and implications of the digital transformation. He is currently working with SASCOM to encourage innovation ecosystem in Sri Lanka. Hailing all the way from Berlin, Germany, Chris Dory.
Thank you. Thanks for inviting me. Good evening. How shall we do it? Is there anything here? Let's just get started right away, if possible. Yeah, I'm here since 2 months, and people ask me a lot about how do I come up with a good business idea, how do I know it's a good one anyway, and I thought I would just share some very personal stories about what I have been doing. It's not necessarily success stories, a lot of it, what I'm going to tell is pure failure, but that's the point, I guess. Back in 2006, I was a student at Bauhaus University in Weimar, and we did like a project with the Pratt Institute in New York, and it was on taxi. We were asked to innovate the taxi industry. At this time, 2006, people started to have these little machines, these little gadgets in their cars, GPS trackers. Do you remember? Maybe not. It's a long time, it's like 12 years ago, right? So I did a lot of research, I talked to the taxi driver in my hometown, I did interviews, and I thought this GPS thing is actually quite interesting, because if people start having these things, we can track the taxis, and then we can link the consumers directly to the taxi drivers, and we don't need any middleman anymore, right? So now this is maybe something that I could explore. So I wrote the concept for this. But the thing was, this concept did not at all fit my academic context. Like, nobody would understand it. My professor thought, this is kind of silly. And also it would steal a lot of jobs from the taxi drivers. So I actually got a very bad grade for this project. And also the technological framework wasn't there, right? We had these little GPS machines, but only the drivers, or some of them would have it, but not the consumers. Like, how would the consumers be able to track the taxis? So there was a little, actually quite a big missing link there. So I just stopped, I dropped the project, I was not even thinking about it anymore. And then about 3 years later, now 6.5 billion business came up with exactly this same framework. So in 2007, 1 year after this, the iPhone was introduced, so everyone had a smartphone and everyone was able to use GPS. And in 2009, Uber was founded. So my point is, like, having an idea doesn't mean anything, like, and it's really impossible to judge at this particular time whether it's a good one or not. You just don't know. Like, if you don't do anything about it, then you will never find out. Another thing, as a freshman at art school, I studied at art school, I was asked by a museum to make objects for their Christmas exhibition. So at the end of the year, they would have this exhibition, and they wanted something nice to decorate. So me and my team, we came up with this idea of having these porcelain objects. They called it Yesterday's News, and it would be like crumbled newspapers, like thrown at the Christmas tree. Right. I don't know, unusual concept maybe. So we produced these things, then we've even invented a method to print them. They were made of porcelain, and we were very proud of the results. I went to the museum, showed them what we have worked out, and they were not happy at all is that what is this? Like, we don't get it. We thought about, you know, glitter and light bulbs and whatever. They had an entirely different understanding of what they were expecting. And even my grandfather, he went to later to see the exhibition, and he was like, I don't know, he didn't get it either. But I still, it was actually about to fail an entire project because it was so much in the, like, criticized. But I talked to some people and I thought, no, this is actually a good concept. I took a stand and said, no, we should do it. So we did it. And then a couple days after the exhibition was open, I got a phone call. They were saying, here's a guy, he's a pastor from a local church, and he said he wants to buy the entire collection. So he was at the exhibition, he was saw it and he fell in love with it, and he found it so cool that he actually invested a lot of money to buy all of it at once. And so the entire story entirely changed within a day, just because this one person really liked it. Like, all the others didn't, but he did, and he bought everything. So we made a lot of money from this, and everyone was happy in the end. And actually, nobody was even thinking about the initial, I don't know, doubts and considerations. And they even, like, the same people who didn't like the idea in the first place, they got me the next job, which was also exhibition design. I did the next year. So, yeah, from the initial starting point to this, the entire story changed entirely. Another story is this toy prototype I did a while back. I mean, most of these projects are quite old, right? This is how old I am. But these are also the projects where I learned the most, so this is why I'm sharing this with you. So I had this idea for this toy. I showed it, I presented it at the university exhibition. One of the professors liked it a lot, and he said, this is a fantastic idea, you should file a patent for this and take it to the market. So I did. I got the patent. I invested a lot of money to build another prototype and to get the suppliers and get everything ready to take it to the market. Then I showed the prototype at the trade show, and it was stolen. Like, I was standing at the table and somebody stole it from the table. And I thought, this is the best compliment you could ever get. Like, somebody is actually willing to commit a crime to steal this prototype. Wow, I'm going to be, like, very successful with this. And then I even found a very, very good toy manufacturer, in my opinion, the best in the world, a Swiss company. And they liked it, and I said, yeah, let's make a deal. We will produce it, and we will put it on our program. And then they said, yeah, well, it's in German, right? It's like you play with words. This is how it works. Like, you have letters, and you form words out of it. And it was designed for the German language. I said, well, we are a Swiss company, and our biggest market is actually Japan. So we will do it, but you need to translate it to Japanese, to French, and to Italian, at least. So I actually started doing it because I had so much enthusiasm, but then I thought, this is not going to happen ever. It was so much work, and actually it didn't quite work in the other languages, so the entire project failed because it was just impossible to take it to the global market. This is another project. I started an innovation hub in Berlin with a bunch of friends. And we actually just wanted a place for ourselves to play or to, like, develop our ideas. So we had a bunch of people with 3D scanners, self-made, with laser cutters, with 3D printers, with all this equipment. And we started prototyping our product ideas there. And it was just like a growing community, but it was just for ourselves, basically. So this place attracted a lot of community members, mentors, entrepreneurs, a lot of artists were working there. We had schools, and then we had actually universities and corporates also. They came and visited, and I said, well, this is interesting. What are you doing here? Can we be part of this? Can we book a workshop with you? So I ended up doing a lot of workshops on innovation and like how to come up with product ideas. And I did it with big companies, with Deutsche Telekom, with Bosch, with BMW. So I was never thinking about this could be something they might be interested in. But they came and they asked if I could run a workshop with them. So I did. And I did this like for a couple of years. And it was quite successful economically for me and my friends. But it was never ever intended this way. And even I got a call from the embassy, and they said the secretary for economic development from Hong Kong is going to visit Berlin, and they picked your space and they want to visit it, they want to see it. They heard about it and they actually came with a delegation, and I showed them around, and so it became a very successful thing without me or my co-founders ever having intended this to be like that. And by the way, it led to a lot of jobs I got after. So what my point is, like why I'm telling you all of this, to have one good idea, I think you need to start with at least 100. Like, because you never know, like you cannot come up with this one idea, and then there are so many factors that make your idea a good or a bad one, and there's, in my opinion, no way of like having security in this. So the best way is to actually just have an idea, observe your environment. If you have an idea, just document it somehow, or like take it, prototype it if possible. And if it's not the right time, just keep it there for a while. And you will end up with a lot of them without actually turning them into anything. And I think that's okay. That's just the reality of innovation. It's a very, very wasteful process. So don't even think about that this one idea you have is the right one, or like be bothered with evaluating whether it's a good one or a bad one. It doesn't matter. Just document it, share with people, talk about it, and maybe there will be something coming out of it. Maybe not. You don't know. Yeah, this is, I already said, you never know until you try and you actually prototype. Time-wise. Okay, just keep going for a while. Design thinking. Have you ever heard about design thinking or practiced it? I know there's some in the room who have. design thinking is actually a very practical, hands-on, systematical approach to deal with this. Because during my time in studying design or starting my businesses, it was never really, I never had those structures at hand. I did it my own way, or the way my professors told me or advised me to. But design thinking would actually guide you through a process where you make sure you understand the problem first before you start innovating. And this is in German, I'm sorry, but I can just explain it. You try to understand. You make observations. You find something interesting or intriguing. And this keeps going for a while. Or you define a problem and say, I know this is a problem. I think I might be able to solve it. You might even bring people together to work together on this problem. And then at some point you have to narrow it down, because you have a trillion of options. Like, I mean, imagine how many ideas mankind could possibly have. It's limitless. But at some point you have to narrow it down and look at what's worth addressing or worth developing further. And then you can start exploring again. From this point on, you can consider different alternatives addressing the same problem. Then you have to test it. You have to build something you can interact with or you can try out. As long as it's just in your head or just, I don't know, as a note on paper, that's something, but you have to make sure you can somehow test it and try whether it works or not and then improve it. Yeah, I want to mention some more factors about creativity. On an individual level, you have some factors that make creativity more likely to happen. One is having broad interests, like not being too much. It's very good to be like a specialist in one particular field. That's also good, but at the same time, it's very good to have to be very open and very curious, and have many interests. It might be hobbies or it might be different fields of study. This really helps you to be open-minded and be able to see opportunities as well. Then independence of judgment. I think this is something we mentioned several times in the previous presentation and this one. You kind of have to make your own decision on what you find valuable or not. You don't rely too much on what other people tell you. So you have to, it's good to have independence in your, in your judgment and autonomy. And most importantly, a sense as your, like, see yourself as creative. This is, sounds a bit weird, but it's true. Like, the more you have confidence in your own creativity, the more creative you will actually be. I think there's a quote for this. One of the myths of creativity is that very few people are really creative. The truth is that everyone has great capacities, but not everyone develops them. Everyone is creative. We just tend to forget about forget it because we are forced to narrow down our approaches and our the way we educate ourselves. The next level is the group level. You can, of course, create by yourself, but it might be very helpful to have a group around you that you can work with. For this, trusted relationships are very helpful, of course. Like, you have to trust your co-workers or your partners. An inspiring environment, I think that's obvious. And then diversity in the groups. That's most important. That's very, very helpful to have people around you that have a different viewpoint, that have a different background, that have different experiences than yourself. So you can broaden your horizon exponentially just by being exposed to those people, right? It might be, like, you might feel more comfortable to stick with your peers and people who are exactly the same as you. Of course, I'm the same, right? It's more easy. But it's definitely more interesting and more leads more towards innovation if you get out of your comfort zone and be in touch with people who are entirely different than yourself. And then you have the organizational level. This might be your team as a startup, or this might be the company you're working, or the suppliers you work with, or the people, the structures you're operating in. One thing is, creativity takes time. I already mentioned, like, there will be a lot of try and error, and a lot of the initiatives you take, they will fail, and you will start from scratch, and it will be kind of wasted time, or wasted energy in a way. But I guess that's just the way it is. It just takes its time. Can take very long, but the organization or the structure should give the freedom to explore and to fail. Rewarding creative behavior. That's, in a lot of environments, in a lot of contexts, creativity isn't really rewarded. You're supposed to just do what you're told, and if you come up with alternatives, then this might not be seen as a positive thing. Hierarchies can also be killers for creativity, because you just don't feel you should mention your idea or consider alternatives. And tolerance of failure. I think that's obvious from what we heard already, right?